make welcome our pastor from North Carolina, Ron Brisson, as he comes to speak to us in a very important experience of the Lord. Praise God. Are you praying for him? Pray for him.
Amen. When someone goes to purchase a new automobile, they go to the dealership and look around the car lot, they'll find out that there are items that come standard equipment on cars. There are other items that are called optional equipment, and you can buy those and pay extra for them if you want to. And I feel like telling you as we begin this morning that when we talk about holiness and sanctification, we are not talking about optional equipment for a Christian. I don't know how it could get much more basic than what we're going to talk about this morning, or how the subject could be much more important than it is. As a matter of fact, I was thinking about how wonderful the worship has been in this assembly. Haven't you enjoyed it? Did you know that there is a correlation between worship and holiness? The Bible says in Psalm 96, verse 9, "Oh, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness." Now, that reminded me when I was thinking about that, about Psalm 119, where David prayed, "Accept, O Lord. Lord, I want you to accept the freewill offerings of my mouth." Now, that lets me know that we could offer some things to the Lord sometimes, and if our heart is not right, he might not accept the worship that we give to him. I believe we could sing "How Great Thou Art" till we turn blue in the face. And if we've got sin in our lives and we know it's there and we refuse to get rid of it, we're probably just wasting our time. Psalm 66 verse 18 says, "If I regard sin in my heart, the Lord will not hear me." So this is important today, what we're going to be talking about over the next few moments. A few months ago, I met a man in our community who was inquiring about the location of our local church. When I told him where we were located, he blurted out, "Oh, you mean that Holiness Church?" Now, it was not what he said that bothered me as much as it was how he said it. You could just hear it in his voice. And you could read it in his condescending facial expression. "You're the pastor of that church? The church that believes in holiness? Surely you don't still believe that holiness stuff till today. You don't expect people to take you seriously today, do you? In the year 2006, when you start talking about holiness? Well, I'm here to tell you today, I do expect us to take this seriously today, because holiness is extremely important, as we're going to see as we go through this morning. That, however, the comment that man made to me, it wasn't so much the words he said, but it was the feeling behind it, pretty well sums up the attitudes concerning holiness in this world in which we live today. You don't hear a lot of talk about this. Somebody came up to me yesterday and in this assembly and said, "Now you know that holiness and sanctification is the forgotten doctrine, don't you?" I want to tell you it's not forgotten, and we want to bring it to life. I thank God for that sermon we heard yesterday morning about holiness, living holy in an unholy world, and we want to follow up with some of those thoughts today. Bruce Wilkinson, the author of The Prayer of Jabez, and also perhaps a lesser known book entitled Set Apart, Discovering Personal Victory Through Holiness. In that book, Bruce tells how he once asked a group of Christian men to describe a holy person. The responses he received were revealing and at the same time somewhat humorous. One man wrote, "People who consider themselves holy live hard lives, with hidden troubles, carrying big black Bibles around to remind them of what they shouldn't be doing." Well, that doesn't sound very good, does it? And then another man said, "To live or to be holy is to live in the valley of no. Say no to everything that has color or joy or spontaneity or humor or variety or creativity. Things like football, music with a beat, and a thick, medium, rare T-bone steak. I don't know what the steak has to do with holiness, but that was his view. I could certainly identify with living in the valley of no. Can't you? Holiness is like that famous painting, one man said. That famous painting of the old couple, you know, the one where they're standing sternly next to their barn and the husband's holding a pitchfork. Now, when I read that, that just intrigued me, so I had to go back and find that picture. I just want you to look at it for just a moment, because in the minds of many people, that's the image that they have of holiness. Drab, black and white clothes, your hair kind of pinned back, and the stern, almost mad expression on the face. I got to tell you, that doesn't have anything to do with holiness. As a matter of fact, as I was looking at that painting and the expression on that man's face and what he's holding in his hand, and I noticed it must be his wife who's standing a little bit behind him. And if you'll notice, her eyes are looking over towards him, maybe glancing past that pitchfork. I got to tell you, if I was married to that man, he had a pitchfork in his hand and looked that mean, I think I'd stand behind him and watch him too. But there's a lot of people in the world today who believe in holiness that look about the same way. Not very attractive, is it? As a matter of fact, can't you just see the love and the glory of God oozing out from that man's countenance? So many people today define holiness with words like serious, solemn, sad, boring, rigid, super religious. It's no wonder why so many people today have a negative image of holiness. Now I want you to stay with me and think with me for just a few. Will you help me this morning? Please do. Now we are believers in the Word of God. Amen? We believe in being filled with the Spirit. Amen? We believe also that the Spirit of God produces in us fruit. Anybody ever heard of the fruit of the Spirit? Love, joy, and peace. That's as far as I want to go this morning. Love, joy, and peace. Have you ever stopped to think? And I find it extremely interesting that that is exactly what the world is searching for today. Love, joy, and peace. If you'll think about it, they sing it in their songs. Now, I know their version of love, joy, and peace has been perverted, but they can't help that. If they don't know the God we know, and the Spirit of God is not indwelling their lives and producing the genuine thing, we can't blame them for not getting it right. But the world is extremely interested in love and joy and peace. They sing it in their songs, they write it in their poetry, they depict it in their television programs and movies. But if you'll think about it, on the one hand, the world is searching for love and joy and peace, and they have at the same time a very negative attitude about holiness. While on the other hand, it's holiness which we have said for years opens the door to the baptism and the fullness of the Spirit. Are you with me? Now, I'll submit to you today that there's been a conspiracy and Satan is the culprit. We know the Bible tells us to put on the whole armor of God that we may be able to stand against the wiles, the game plan, the strategy of the devil. It's obvious, isn't it, that Satan has laid out a strategy to keep people from experiencing genuine love and joy and peace. Now think with me. If being cleansed and sanctified is a prerequisite to being filled with the Spirit, if holiness is necessary for living in the Spirit and walking in the Spirit, if holiness opens the door and prepares the way for the Spirit of God to indwell and infill, then it's only logical that the devil would fight holiness any way he can. You see, the devil wants to make holiness look unattractive. Perhaps that explains some of the negative attitudes that some people have concerning holiness. The devil wants to make holiness look unattractive. C.S. Lewis once wrote these words, "How little people know who think that holiness is dull. When one meets the real thing, it is irresistible. If even 10% of the world's population had it, would not the whole world be converted and happy before a year's end?" I say C.S. Lewis had it right. How little people know who think that holiness is dull. When one meets the real thing, it is irresistible. So many people today have unbiblical attitudes about what holiness means. Even among some Christians, there is great hesitation to embrace a belief in the possibility of personal holiness. Now, we all can come together in a meeting like we're in today, and we can lift our hands and we can sing, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty." And we don't have a bit of problem doing that. But when you take that attribute of God, His holiness, and then propose that we as Christians are supposed to live holy lives, some people say, "No way, that's absurd, it cannot happen." But I want to share with you today from the Word of God that it is possible to live holy. As a matter of fact, it's not only possible, it is required of us that we live holy in this world. And the world may not see it as being attractive, and the world may not be able to understand it. But when the real genuine article, when we really get sanctified, when we really get cleansed, when we really begin to live holy and do it the biblical way, with a smile on our face and joy in our heart, it will be irresistible to this world that we're living before today. God's Word makes it very clear, repeatedly in fact, that God requires holiness from His people. He actually has expectations of us that we live holy lives in this present world. Most likely all of us have heard of the surveys taken primarily in the United States, please listen, that show very little difference nowadays between the lifestyles of professing Christians and those in the world. We're told that there is as much ungodliness of lifestyle among churchgoers as there is in the world. One can hardly, based on lifestyle, habits, and behavior, one can hardly tell any appreciable difference between the believer and the sinner nowadays. Is that true? If there were ever a time for us to trumpet the doctrine of sanctification and holiness, that time is now. People need to know about the power of the blood of Jesus, which can break habitual sin in the life of any man, woman, boy, or girl. Now, sometimes in our church I do this, and I want to do it today. If we sing songs and we know them well, we can clap our hands and sing and be in another country and go right through and never miss a word. Sometimes I just like to strip away the music and just look at the words. As a matter of fact, as you see these words on the screen, some of them will be in bold print and will be underlined. I would like for you to read those underlined words with me today as we think about what our Lord can do. Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you, or evil, a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. Would you be free from your passion and pride? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. Listen, would you be whiter, much whiter than snow? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. Now sing the chorus with me, would you? There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Do you believe that? Do you really believe that? That sin stains can be washed and we can be cleansed and made righteous and holy before God? Oh, I believe that today. I know you believe it too, because we in this church have long believed in personal holiness. From the very beginning, this church has embraced the biblical doctrines of sanctification and holiness, and I consider it a privilege today to be able to talk to you about these doctrines from the Word of God. When one begins to study the meanings of the words holiness and sanctification, it soon becomes apparent that three primary ideas usually surface. The first is separation. The second is cleansing. And the third is dedication. Clearly, God's word illustrates all three. Could everybody say separation? In the Old Testament book of Exodus, chapter 3, we read the word holy. Could you say holy? We read the word holy for the very first time in Scripture. Now, those who are concerned with the interpretation of Scripture have long spoken of the law of first mention. This principle states that whenever one finds a word being used in the Bible for the very first time, one should study it carefully because it is often of extreme significance. That, I believe, is true this morning. Exodus 3, verses 2 through 6. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto Moses in a flame of fire out of the midst of a bush. And behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. And he said, draw not nigh hither. Put off thy shoes from off thy feet. For the place wherein thou standest, or the place whereon thou standest, is holy ground. And Moses hid his face, the scripture says, for he was afraid to look upon God. Often I have wondered about this passage and about the holy ground. Was this ground holy 30 days before the bush burned? I doubt it. It was desert land, wilderness, rough terrain, with all kinds of reptiles and varmints running around. Not what we would usually consider holy ground. Was this ground holy ground 30 days after the burning bush incident? Probably not. Actually, what made this ground holy ground was the fact that God was there. You see, the songwriter got it right, I think, when he wrote these words. This is holy ground. We're standing on holy ground, for the Lord is present, and where he is holy. You see, it's God's presence that made that ground holy ground that day. This place, right here where we're seated, this place is holy ground during this General Assembly. Would you agree with that? Why? Because God is here. Now, 2 weeks ago, in this very building, when World Wrestling Entertainment had an event they called SmackDown, I doubt this would have been considered holy ground. But here over the last 4 or 5 days, as we bring the presence of the Lord with us and we sing and we worship, this has become holy ground. You see the difference? Holy ground is where God is. Now, I've always been, I guess, intrigued by this idea, because the Bible says that the Lord said to Moses two things. As Moses turns aside to see the burning bush, the Lord said to him, number one, don't come any closer. Draw not nigh hither. Don't come. I know we don't talk like that now. When was the last time you said to somebody, draw not nigh hither? Don't come any closer, Moses. That's the first thing he said. And the second thing he said was, take your shoes from off your feet, for this is holy ground. Now, I've wondered about that. Sometimes I'll just be driving down the road wondering about things. I know you do the same thing. And one day, and after I had been assigned this topic, I was driving down the road about to turn into the hospital, and all of a sudden it hit me. You ever had anything just hit you? All of a sudden, my mind went back to verse 1, which we skipped earlier. Verse 1 of that chapter gives us a hint and provides a beautiful illustration, a word picture, I think, of what holiness really is and what it involves. The Bible tells us in verse 1, now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And in case we might miss that, it goes on to say, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert. Notice that Moses kept the flock and that he led the flock. Are you still with me? Moses was a shepherd. He mixed and mingled with the sheep. He fed them. He watered them. He protected them. He provided for them. The nature of his work required that he work in close proximity to animals that could be messy. Moses has no doubt stepped into some messy places. Are you still with me? Are you? Now I'll submit to you, if Moses were to come to your house wearing those shoes, you would say, Moses, don't come any closer. Take your shoes from off your feet. How many times have some of you ladies said to your children, or maybe to your husband, take those filthy shoes off before you come through this house? Ever done that? You don't want all that filth tracked in your house and all over your carpet. Is that true? Well, Moses has been for a good long while. I'm just telling you what the Word says. Moses has been for a good long while now watching and mingling with the sheep, caring for the flock. His shoes are messed up. And God says, take your shoes off your feet because the place where you're coming to is holy ground. Listen, do you get the picture that the Holy Ghost has drawn for us the first time in the Bible that holiness is mentioned? Before we can come into the presence, before we can dwell in the presence of a holy God, we've got to separate from ourselves the mess that has attached itself to us. No, sir. We cannot dwell in his presence. We cannot have fellowship with him. We cannot have intimacy with a holy and a righteous God with filth and mess in our hearts, in our minds, and in our behavior. Because sin always, always, sin always separates from God. It did in the Garden of Eden and it does today. Habakkuk 1:13 says about God, thou art of purer eyes than to behold evil and canst not look on iniquity. Think about that. Isaiah 59, 2 says, your iniquities have separated between you and your God. I think this one's my favorite. Who shall ascend unto the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands and a pure heart. Psalm 24, verses 3 and 4. We have to separate ourselves from the filth and the mess of this world. Listen, mess will attach itself to you before you even know it if you're not careful. Television, radio, internet, magazines, mess is everywhere. And if we're not careful, we'll pick up a little something and not even realize it. And I'm here to tell you, maybe it would be a good idea every now and then if we just kind of look around, see if we picked up any mess somewhere before we attempt to go into the presence of God. Because God wants us to be clean and holy with clean hands and a pure heart before we're going to be able to dwell with Him. Have intimacy and fellowship with Him. Thank the Lord. Thank the Lord. What a picture of holiness. What a picture of holiness. Take those filthy shoes off because you're coming to holy ground. Separation. That's the first idea that helps us understand holiness. The second is cleansing. Could everybody say cleansing? Isaiah 6 is the passage that so beautifully illustrates this. Isaiah has a vision. He's allowed to see into the very throne room of God. He sees the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up. He sees the seraphim, and he hears them cry out, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Listen to what it says. The doorpost shook at the voice of the seraphim. The house was filled with smoke. God was there, and this was holy ground, the throne room of God. Isaiah's vision is glorious, to say the least. And it's interesting to study, but so is his reaction to the vision. Listen to what Isaiah said when he saw God in his holiness. Isaiah said, woe is me, for I am undone. I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. How did he know that? For mine eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. You see, Isaiah laments his own condition. Woe, he groans. Today we would do it this way. We would say, oh, I am undone. Coming into the presence of God, it always has that effect. You ever noticed? When we come into the presence of God, it makes us want to bow. It makes us want to humble ourselves. It makes us want to surrender before the Lord. We just melt before the Lord when we come into His presence. Listen, no man struts, no man boasts, no man brags in the presence of God. We just melt before Him and we surrender to Him. That's what happened to Isaiah. That's what happens in our lives. In response to Isaiah's cry, listen what happened. Then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs from off the altar. And he laid it upon my mouth and said, lo, this hath touched thy lips, and thine iniquity is taken away, and thy sin is purged. You know, that's what we need in these days in which we live. A cleansing fire, the fire of God to touch our lives and burn away everything that defiles. It was in this General Assembly a few years ago that many of us were first introduced to that old hymn out of the Blue Book, which contains these words. Thou Christ of burning, cleansing flame, send the fire. Thy blood-bought gift today we claim. Send the fire today. God of Elijah, hear our cry. Send the fire. He'll make us fit to live or die. Send the fire today. I like this part. For strength to ever do the right, for grace to conquer in the fight, for power to walk the world in white. Send the fire today. You see, when we come into the presence of a holy God, I wonder if we see in ourselves, like Isaiah did, things which God would see as undesirable. For so long, we may have focused on outward things and failed to address more significant things like unforgiveness and bad attitudes and gossip and backbiting. I think it's significant that Isaiah's proclamation was, "Woe is me, for I am undone. Watch me now. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips." You see, we got to be careful what comes out of our mouths. We got to guard diligently what we allow these eyes to look upon. We got to be careful what these ears listen to. Several weeks ago, I find myself in a sermon encouraging all of us who were then present to ask ourselves these questions during the coming week. Would the Holy Ghost be grieved by what's coming out of my mouth today? Would what I'm watching on television tonight grieve the Spirit of God? How about what I listen to on the radio or read in a magazine or see on the internet? Would that grieve the Spirit? Coming into the presence of a holy God will always reveal that which is undesirable in our lives. Isaiah said, "Woe is me." The Apostle Peter said, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man." David said it this way, "Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me." Thank God that we not only have forgiveness of sins, but that we can also be cleansed from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. Our very nature can be transformed by the sanctifying power of Jesus Christ. Now, this sanctification of which we speak, it goes deeper than turning over a new leaf. It's much more than trying to do better. The power of the gospel can make of us new creatures in Christ Jesus, where truly all things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. Well, I think about sometimes how we get saved and it's all okay. But as time goes on, if we're not careful, we pick up things. I've got a sign on my desk at home, just a little sign that says, Clutter is the thief of time. Do you know why that little sign is on my desk? Because I have a problem sometimes keeping my desk cleaned up. And then when I want to find something, I have to, you must know what I'm talking about. And I have to sort through all kinds of things to find what I'm looking for. And every once in a while, I'll go back and clean it up, and it'll be spotless and just as clean. And I find after another 4 or 5 days, it's all cluttered up all over again. I thought about what happens in our lives. As we come before the Lord and we get all clean and pure before Him, and if we're not careful after a little while, we may have picked up a few things and need to go back and make sure it's still clean all over again. May need to go back and revisit the Lord who cleansed us and ask Him to do it for us again. You see, let's not underestimate the power of the blood. People may be bound with all kinds of things. The chorus to an old song says, "Jesus breaks every fetter." Jesus breaks every fetter. Jesus breaks every fetter, and He sets me free. Next verse says, "I'm now on the altar. I'm now on the altar. I am now on the altar which was made for me." And then the fourth verse, it kind of seals it. It's a time of celebration. After you've done the first two, it says, "I will shout hallelujah. I will shout hallelujah. I will shout hallelujah, for He sets me free." Two basic elements that help define for us holiness and sanctification in Scripture: separation and cleansing. These have been illustrated through Moses and Isaiah. Moses was told to separate from himself those filthy shoes which had been worn while working among the sheep so that he could come into the presence of a holy God. Isaiah, when he was in the presence of a holy God, recognized how defiled he was, cried out, and was cleansed with fire from the altar. In each of these two examples, Moses and Isaiah, the third element can also be seen. Could everybody say dedication? As a result of Moses' encounter with God, he was now dedicated to the task of leading God's people out of Egyptian bondage. Isn't that great? As a result of Isaiah's encounter with God, when God asked him, "Who shall I send and who will go for us?" Isaiah replied, "Here am I, send me." From that time forth, Isaiah was dedicated to speaking what thus saith the Lord. Now listen, if Moses needed to separate himself from filth and Isaiah needed to be cleansed, would any among us deny that we too need the sanctifying power of Christ to burn away any defilement? If before being dedicated to the work of God, they had to be separated and cleansed, how could we think that God required less from us? The Apostle Paul said it this way: if any man purge himself from these, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet, that means easily used by the master, and prepared unto every good work. 2 Timothy 2:21. Separation, cleansing, dedication. Three elements to help us better understand holiness and sanctification. These two Old Testament examples further help us by illustrating whose responsibility it is to accomplish holiness in our lives. You still with me? Please listen carefully. Whose responsibility is it to accomplish holiness in our lives? Some might say, "Oh, that's easy. It's God's responsibility to accomplish holiness in our lives." Fact of the matter is, it's not all up to God, and it's not all up to us either. The Bible says we are laborers together with God, and I think that is nowhere more true than it is right here in this subject. There are times when a person struggling with some sin, you ever known someone who is struggling with a sin? There are times when a person struggling with some sin will say, "If God would just take the desire away from me, I would stop." You ever heard that? Sometimes that's a simple admission that they don't want to put forth any real effort on their own, and that they expect God to do it all. But God always expects us to do what we can for ourselves, to do our best, and then He specializes in doing the rest. Then on the other hand, there are those who try and struggle with some sin in their life, failing every time. Why? Because they are trusting in their own ability to try and make themselves holy, and it simply cannot be done. They need to cry out to God like Isaiah did. For Scripture says, when we are weak, He is strong. Now please listen. This requirement that we do our part is certainly reflected in the New Testament Scriptures. Please note carefully the underlined words that you see on your screen. Scripture says, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify. Incidentally, that's the same word in the original as sanctify. Sanctify your hearts, you double-minded. James 4, verses 7 and 8. We are the sons of God, and when he shall appear, we shall be like him. And every man that hath this hope in him purifieth, same word as sanctify in the original, purifieth or sanctifieth himself even as he is pure. 1 John 3, 2 and 3. Having therefore these promises, dearly beloved, let us cleanse ourselves from all filthiness of the flesh and spirit, perfecting or completing holiness in the fear of God. You see, this means that we have a part to play in this business of living holy. We submit. We resist. We draw near to God. We cleanse our hands. We purify ourselves. We complete holiness in the fear of God. Listen, we can't do it all, but we've got to do our part. Some people, it seems, are waiting for a lightning bolt from heaven to hit them in the top of the head before they start trying to live holy. They don't want to put forth any effort or to try at all. Now, I know it would be easier. I know it would be easier if we could take a holy pill. You didn't know there was a holy pill, did you? Neither did I. It would be easier if we could take a pill and be holy, wouldn't it? Wouldn't that be great? Just doesn't work that way, however. Christians have to learn to say no to some things. Sure, God will forgive us. Sure, he will wash us and cleanse us. There's no doubt that he will sanctify us wholly. But children of God are going to have to learn to say no to some things in this world. Have you ever watched a bunch of chickens? They just scratch around. They'll scratch and then step back and see where they scratch. Then they'll peck around a little bit, take another step or two and scratch, and then peck around where they scratched. I want to tell you today that as Christians, we can't be like chickens during the week, pecking around and scratching in the things of the world, and then expect to fly like an eagle on Sunday. It won't work that way. We got to get our lives clean and pure before God and come into his presence and allow him to fill us, sanctify us, and cleanse us. Part of Satan's conspiracy that I talked about earlier, his conspiracy to defeat us involves something very subtle. Well, actually, it's not subtle at all anymore. The prince of the power of the air is using the airwaves to program and brainwash people into accepting all kinds of filth and sin into their living rooms they would never have accepted 20 years ago. Now that is the truth. It's embarrassing what is on television these days. And I'm not even talking about HBO. I want to tell you, the world can sit in their living rooms and they can watch it. And they can laugh, and they can love it, and they can lust. You tell me that's not the intent of many of the programs that are being produced nowadays? The world can sit there and watch all that stuff, but I got to tell you, as people of God, we've got to learn to say no to some things. I'm not saying we got to throw our TV out the door, but I'll tell you what, we better turn it sometimes, because if we fill ourselves with garbage all week, there's no way we're going to be full of the glory of God on Sunday and ready to worship him. We've got to say no to some things. Maybe it would be good to be reminded of what the scripture says. Follow holiness, without which no man shall see the Lord. So yes, God will cleanse and sanctify. But we still have a responsibility to purify our own hearts and minds and cleanse our hands and complete holiness. We have the responsibility to walk soberly and righteously and godly in this present world. Moses was told to separate himself from some things before coming into the presence of a holy God. Isaiah felt the need for cleansing when he found himself in the presence of a holy God. And we, my friends, if we expect intimate fellowship with a holy God, we've got to walk in holiness. Got to do it. As I prepare to bring this to a close, I want to share this scripture with you. Psalm 93, verse 5 says, "Holiness becometh thine house, O Lord, forever." Holiness becomes thy house, O Lord, forever. When I read that scripture and thought about what it means, it just seems like to me I could see the Lord looking down on us, saying, holiness sure does look good on you. See, the fact of the matter is the bridegroom is looking down at his bride. The Bible says the bride hath made herself ready. And as the Lord looks down on us, as we go through this wicked and sinful world, as we walk in holiness before the Lord, I believe the Lord just looks down and says, holiness sure does look good on you. Would you stand with me as we bring this to a close today?